taking it, I want to show you this classic David Attenborough cordyceps fungus video. And so cordyceps is a genus of fungus that's parasitic. And we should be thankful, if you will, that there are no cordyceps that are parasites on humans, because if there were, life would become a lot more scary and potentially horrific.
Have infiltrated their bodies and their mind. These bullet ants are showing some worrying symptoms. Spores from a parasitic fungus called cordyceps have infiltrated their bodies and their minds. Infected brain directs this ant upwards. Then, utterly disorientated, it grips a stem with its mandibles. Those afflicted, that are discovered by the workers, are quickly taken away and dumped far away from the colony. It seems extreme, but this is the reason why. Like something out of science fiction, the fruiting body of the cordyceps erupts from the ant's head. It can take 3 weeks to grow, and when finished, the deadly spores will burst from its tip. Then, any ant in the vicinity will be in serious risk of death. The fungus is so virulent, it can wipe out whole colonies of ants. And it's not just ants that fall victim to this killer. There are, literally, thousands of different types of cordyceps fungi, and remarkably, each specializes on just one species. These attacks do have a positive effect on the jungle's diversity, since parasites like these stop any one group of animal getting the upper hand. The more numerous a species becomes, the more likely it will be attacked by its nemesis, a cordyceps fungus.
There you go. Let's see why I said it's a good thing there aren't any cordyceps that infiltrate humans. Like, hey, a fungus growing out of the top of your head, you might want to see your physician. There is treatment for that, you know. Yeah. Had any of you seen that before? Cordyceps, a few of you?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah.
Does it matter how large the animal is, or is it just like exclusively
Well, they only, to my knowledge, they only are parasites on insects. And I'm not aware that there's like a certain size of insect that becomes safe if they don't. So it's just insects, though. Yeah, right. I don't think they even attack like spiders, which are related closely to insects, or centipedes, which are very related, but arthropods, I'm pretty sure, might be wrong, that it's just insects. And even if it isn't just insects, it's not beyond arthropods, which are pretty distantly related to us. So we're safe, unless there's some kind of big mutation that allows a a host chef, but pretty unlikely.
Right. So I missed the very, very beginning. So if they notice that they're, if it's just that they die, they just carry them off.
Right. So ants in the colony, coming up a little twig and sees one of their brethren with a cordyceps coming out of
his
head.
They see the problem.
And they pick up that ant and carry it off and dispose of it, like take it away from the colony so the spores don't get in the colony. Yeah, it is amazing. Yeah. It's amazing what natural selection will do to favor certain behaviors, you know. So it always goes back to that. Beginning topics of what we did in here is you get a genetic change that just happens to produce an ant that, you know, does this behavior, just automatic, and of course that's going to spread by natural selection because it's going to favor colonies that have that behavior. They're going to survive more. So yeah, pretty amazing. Okay, so we get started with animals here, and we've just got about 10, 11 minutes to get going. And we'll cover a lot of this and go into chapter 33 on Thursday. So introduction to animal diversity. And so this chapter is relatively short, but it gives us kind of a general background or framework. Gives us sort of a general framework of what an animal is and what some of the general themes are in the animal world or zoology, and then from that we can use it as a launching pad to investigate specific diversity and functional kind of topics in the animal world. So the chapter, as usual, starts off with kind of a case study, an example, right, to give the framework of what the whole chapter is going to be. And starts off with this chameleon, and a spectacular lizard. Of course, you could use almost any animal. It could be a great poster child in its own right for, talking about the major themes of what it is to be an animal. But this is a good one. So overall, animals are characterized in comparison to other lineages by having specialized nerve and muscle cells. There aren't any other lineages that have specialized muscle and nerve cells, and that kind of coordinated messaging system and motility system allows animals to do things that no other kinds of creatures on Earth can do. Allows us to detect through receiving stimuli and responding. Our nervous system is doing that. And once we've detected, of course, then our nervous system coordinated with our muscular system can capture prey. All kinds of fascinating ways that animals have evolved for capture, or in terms of getting away from being captured, evasion, right? Whether it be hopping or burrowing or swimming or flying, there's all kinds of stuff. And so there's very diverse, also, and efficient digestive systems. So that has allowed animals to diversify and capitalize on all different kinds of feeding strategies, lots of different. And so the chameleon is just a great representative example of doing this. In its own right, in the lizard world, or snake and lizard world, chameleons, of course, are specialized for being arboreal predators. So just to throw in a couple, kind of herpetology facts, their body is laterally compressed, which gives them more stability for hanging on twigs and climbing. They've got eyes that can independently rotate around, so they can basically look all around in their 360-degree world for prey and predators. They have a prehensile tail that they can wrap around and hang on to things so they don't drop or fall. They have digits like ours, homologous to ours, that are modified for grasping, digits that are fused together for grasping. So they have that long tongue, of course, is homologous to our tongue, but it's evolved a system for having a projectile tongue, alien-like, for capturing prey at some distance. So, the chameleon makes a great poster child for, this kind of lifestyle. So, what is an animal? That's how we're going to get started. What are some of the characteristics of animals? So, first of all, animals are multicellular and heterotrophic. Now, of course, in so far in here, we've talked about other kinds of creatures that are multicellular, such as what? Okay, but what type of protists? Because remember, there are unicellular protists that dominate, but there's a couple types of protists that involve multicellularity, such as, those aren't protists. Red algae, okay? So that's one type, multicellularity. Or the sister taxon to red algae is who? Green, right? So the green plants evolve multicellularity. So my point is, other things have evolved multicellularity. So that's not just unique to animals. And heterotrophic. Well, who do we just talk about that's heterotrophic? The fungi, right? But what sets animals apart from fungi in terms of their feeding? I mentioned this just a little bit earlier. Whereas fungi secrete enzymes from their hyphae to digest what's outside of them, what do? We ingest, right? So we're putting food into us. So that's a unique combination, this unique feeding mode. We ingest, sets us apart from fungi, and digest inside of us. Okay. So our cells lack cell walls. So that allows us to be motile. We can move, we can change the shapes of our cells, and so that means we're not like fixed in place, like a plant has got cellulose cell walls, okay? Can't move. Fungi have what in their cell walls? You said it though. Chitin, right, chitin. And so that makes them rigid, you know, but for us, we've retained the ancestral condition of not having cell walls. So original eukaryotic cells didn't have cell walls, so we can change shape. We also have specialized proteins that other lineages do not have that have a structural role. So that helps us to like make tissues and hold our cells together in sheets. Collagen is total animal protein. It's uniquely animal. And collagen makes up, I don't know if you remember from Bio 181, it's an enormous component of our total protein content as an animal. It's holding us together. And you also might remember from Bio 181, because we've covered it, that animals have three types of junctions. Tight junctions and desmosomes, remember those? Gap junctions. So that's animal. And that's for, you know, holding tissues together and cells together, and gap junctions are for sharing cytosol and communicating, so that's animal. And then lastly, on the bottom here, so these images are accompanying number three. So I'm talking about collagen out in the extracellular matrix. I'm talking about junctions that are between cells. And then on the bottom, it's bringing back what was said on the intro slide, nervous and muscle tissue in most animals. Allow rapid and coordinated movements that allow things like chameleons and cheetahs and sharks, all kinds of rapid moving, rapidly insects, grasshoppers. Yeah. So do you know from reading ahead of time perhaps what type of animal does not have nervous and muscle tissue? It's the one basal lineage of animal doesn't have those. You might clean up with them. Sponges, right. So sponges are the basal lineage of animals, and so they are lacking a couple of the things that we typically think of as animal. And then continuing this, what is an animal? Homeotic genes. When we went over plants, I mentioned to you homeotic genes. I said homeotic genes are sets of genes for coordinating a body plan, for coordinating the position and arrangement of body parts. So in plants, homeotic genes are controlling where there's roots, where there's leaves, where there's stems. In animals, homeotic genes are coordinating where to put legs, where to put mouth parts, where to put wings. And there's a unique set of homeotic genes that only found in animals. Sounds like fox, but they are hawks, right? And it's not the bird hawks, it's H-O-X. And again, this is an example of something that's found in all animals except sponges. Yeah. So, the hawks genes, they regulate other genes and they control body development, where parts are going. Now, we can see in the phylogeny of animals that we're going to move into that we can see increased complexity of animals, of the phylogeny, and it coincides with duplications of hox genes, copying hox genes. And when those hox genes get duplicated and copied, then those new copies can then start coordinating new types of patterns of development, you know, doing new things, tinkering around. And that's arguably how we and other vertebrates and so on became so complex. This is what we see just quickly, like looking at a fruit fly, is there's these different hox genes that are coordinating the position of different body parts. Huge, hugely important. And then finally, in this, what is an animal? Animals are typified by sexual reproduction with a dominant diploid state. We just came out of talking about fungi, and the dominant stage in fungi was being haploid, right? And so being having diploid, and there's a very common set of embryonic developmental stages that happen in animals. And all animals, again, except sponges, develop from embryos, very, very early embryos. We're not talking about an embryo that actually starts to look like the animal. But the earliest stages, and these embryos have layers called ectoderm and endoderm that develop into the body covering. The ectoderm develops into the body covering, and the endoderm in the embryo develops into the gut. So, just want to finish up with this slide, and then we'll leave more of this chapter for Thursday. So let me just finish this up. So, after you get a zygote and you start to get cleavage, right? So think of like a cleaver, kitchen, a knife. Cleaving is cutting in half. So when we talk about cleavage in an early embryo, we're talking about the cells dividing and cleaving, making more cells. So that's called early cleavage. And during this early cleavage process, the embryo develops into a hollow ball of cells called a blastula. Now, appropriately, it's near Halloween, and so you might dress up as Count Dracula, but now that you're informed with this, you could potentially dress up as a Count Blastula and be kind of comical. Hey, what are you? I'm a Blastula. Yeah. So what happens is the Blastula is this hollow ball, and then imagine like taking a piece of dough or silly putty and punching it. Boom, punching your dough and you make a cavity inside. Poof, punching your dough down. Well, what happens is the blastula starts to cave inwards, a cavity, and that cavity is called the how do you pronounce CH? Cub. Archenteron. And this is what's going to develop into the gut. This is what's going to develop into the digestive cavity. At this point, when the embryo has got this gut that's forming, this archenteron, this stage is the gastrula. So if you're going out for Halloween with a friend or a partner, one of you can dress up as Count Blastula, and the other could be Count Gastrula. But I don't know that any of you will end up doing that. Now the opening to this cavity is called the blastopore. That's the opening. And what we're going to see on Thursday is that opening, that originally opening, becomes one of two things in later animals. It becomes either the mouth or the other opening at the other end of the tube, the anus, right? So we'll see which animal group the blastopore develops into which opening. So the last thing here is most embryos develop into a larva, a larval stage. Most animals have a larva. Do we? No. So a larva is something that generally is is free living. You know, it's out swimming, it's out dispersing, and then further developing. No, we're embryos that are attached to our mothers and so on. So we don't have a larval stage, technically. But fish do, frogs and salamanders do. If you're a frog, the larva is called a tadpole, you know, etc. So anyway, I'll send you a reading, you know, assignment, or I guess I've already sent you questions for this whole chapter, but I'll send you some more for chapter 33 that we're going to get into to get prepared. And I'll see you guys, some of you upstairs, in a few minutes, okay? So, send me, oh, it passed.
Yeah.